Good afternoon, everybody. I think we're going to get started. It's really wonderful to see everybody in person, and I want to thank you for being here. This is one of our several events that we've had now in person, and we're really honored to have our guest, Dr. James, who I'll introduce in 1 minute. But it's super to see our PhD students, our colleagues, faculty colleagues in the School of Nursing and also the School of Medicine. So thank you all for being here. So, good afternoon. My name is Julene Johnson, and I'm a professor and the Associate Dean for Research in the UCSF School of Nursing. And we're delighted to have Dr. Kortney James here today with us as our keynote speaker as part of the Nancy Steiger Research Seminar Series. And first of all, I'd like to thank Nancy Steiger for her generous support for this research seminar series. And Ms. Steiger is an alumna of the UCSF School of Nursing, and because of her support, faculty members can nominate rising stars to come spend time with us. And as you all know, we've met with Dr. James in small groups, both with the students and faculty members, and we had lunch. And we will also have this research lecture and the reception that will follow. And we've had a wonderful time learning about Dr. James's research. As a short introduction, Dr. Kortney James is a PhD-prepared nurse and pediatric nurse practitioner who is currently a fellow in the National Clinician Scholars Program at UCLA. She earned a bachelor's in nursing from the University of South Carolina and a master's and a PhD in nursing from Georgia State University. She is also a pediatric nurse practitioner. She recently completed an international maternal health policy elective in England, and I hope she'll talk about that today. And as I mentioned, she's currently a postdoctoral scholar. She has already published in top peer-reviewed journals and is highly sought after as a mentor and also a media commentary. Her program of research focuses on Black maternal health and health equity, and because Dr. James will share her background more extensively during the presentation, she requested that I just provide the objectives of her presentation. So today, Dr. James hopes to accomplish three things through her talk titled Five Times, No More, Centering Black Women and Birthing People to Achieve Perinatal Health Equity. She aims to reassure the nursing students that your educational and career path does not have to be linear to be successful. She also wants to share why mental health and well-being of Black pregnant and postpartum individuals is a public health priority. And finally, she hopes to demonstrate how she plans to improve the care of Black women and birthing people who receive care during and after their pregnancy so that they may live, thrive, and raise their children. So thank you, Dr. James. We're really happy you're here, and it's a great honor to turn the podium over to you. And this session will be recorded for later viewing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for taking time to be here. I'm sure there are plenty of places you could be, but you chose to be here with me, so I thank you. And so, as Dr. Johnson said, thank you for the introduction and for the opportunity to just meet everyone and get to know you all and what you're working on. And so, I'll just go ahead and get started. I'd like to say that if something is unclear or if you need clarity on something, just let me know and I'll address that instead of waiting until the end. I guess I'm like a lifelong student, and so there have been plenty of seminars that I've sat in, and like slide 6, I was confused, and by slide like 20, I was just lost. So just feel free to ask questions. And so I think it's important when we do this work to talk about our positionality, meaning like our identities or experiences that influence how we interpret data, how we communicate data, how we interact and connect with our patients. And so I start with sharing who I am. And so I'm a Black woman, a cisgendered Black woman. I'm also a mother. I'm currently the associate editor of the Nursing for Women's Health Journal, particularly tasked to ensure that our journal is not only the advisory board, but the papers that we publish are diverse in thought, geography, not just race, but also ethnicity, language, and perspectives, because diversity and inclusion is far more than just our outward appearance, but also our thoughts, because that's how we get better. I'm also a pediatric nurse practitioner and clinician researcher, and I'll get into, you know, some of those aspects a little deeper. But I'd like to start out in sharing my mission and long-term goals. I want to reform pregnancy and postpartum care to ensure that Black women and birthing people live and thrive to raise their children. I plan to do this by, one, co-creating solutions with Black women and people capable of pregnancy. I was talking with the doctoral students earlier, and maybe even with faculty, that when we're in our offices or connecting with one another as researchers, we can have the best ideas, or so we like to think they're the best ideas. But if we then go out to the community and share those ideas and try to implement those interventions, and they're like, we don't need that, they're not the best solutions anymore, right? Because you want people to actually do and be a part of the solutions that we create to be most impactful. Secondly, I plan to, and I do, conduct research that is rooted in reproductive justice and health equity to inform health policy and health systems. When thinking about maternal health outcomes, it's more than individual choices and behaviors. There are health policies within clinical practice, but as well as legislation that then shape individual behaviors and choices. So instead of focusing solely on individuals, if we focus on larger structures, we can be more impactful. And so an extension of who I am, just a little more in depth about me. I am a registered nurse. I don't care about storing my age, right? We hope to age. And then, you know, we can be in Dr. Johnson's studies, right? After undergrad in University of South Carolina, which I now know I can't say USC because it's not the USC you all think of, I moved to Atlanta in 2006, and I became a registered nurse at the highest volume birthing center in the country. So we had about 25,000 births a year. Apparently, Atlanta people are really fertile. That's all I know. And produce a lot. So we were pretty busy. I got a lot of experience there as far as I did everything except labor and delivery. So I was lactation, I was NICU, I was transition care nursery. I did it all. And I also have worked in public health, helping different initiatives like WIC, or we had a program for high-risk infant care. And then I became a pediatric nurse practitioner, so also an array of experience there in infectious disease, which was in public health with tuberculosis, and creating treatment plans for kids who had been exposed to or actually had active TB infection. As deputy chief nurse at the Georgia Department of Public Health, I know, you know, people know about Georgia, and you may think of Atlanta, but Atlanta is a very small part of Georgia, and most of Georgia is very rural. So Georgia has 159 counties, and around 60 of those counties have no pediatric providers. And even more, I think around 70 have no obstetric providers. So not just physicians, but even nurse practitioners. And so public health nurses were really important to provide care to citizens of those counties without them having to travel far to get care. And so I was I'm pretty laid back. I don't find myself in charge. But I collaborated with other nurses and physicians to ensure that there were protocols in place that supported them to do the work that they do. And so I'm also a Black woman and mother. That's me when I was good and pregnant, a long time ago now. But I was diagnosed with pregnancy-induced hypertension around 25 weeks. And so at that point, I was a nurse for a long time, and I was well aware of the significance of having this condition and what it could mean for preterm birth and for my baby. And at the time, I was seeing a women's health nurse practitioner, also who had privileges at the hospital that I worked. And so I knew everyone in the practice, because that's why I chose them, because I saw how they operated in the hospital and all the things, right? So I felt pretty confident in choosing them for my care. But at this visit, I was pretty much accused of not taking PIH seriously. I was told that if I wasn't on bed rest and went into labor, it's not guaranteed that your child, that your baby will make it. So you need to take this serious. And so because of my position in that hospital and working there and knowing who to complain to, I was able to see results and ensure that I was not seen or quote-unquote cared for by this person again. But it also made me so aware of people who receive that same care and either don't feel like or actually don't have recourse. But all was well. I was induced at 36 weeks, but Kennedy is stubborn even to this day. I love you, Kennedy. But she came out at 37 weeks. And my health was back. I no longer had, you know, hypertension, and she was good and healthy too. But after that, I finished my master's program because I took a little break, and that's why I mean nursing students, it doesn't have to be linear. You can take your time. Life happens. I went back to school, and I just had a really hard time adjusting to being a new mother. And when I went to the elders in my family or other moms within my family, they all sort of normalized the struggle, this depression, this just this hard time. So I, even though I was a nurse, I felt like, well, I'm not sad. I'm able to go to work. I don't feel depressed, but it's just really hard. I'm really anxious and all these things. And everyone in my family told me that's pretty much what happened. So it's very normalized. So I didn't feel the need to ask for support or to let my clinicians know. But it did make me want to go back to school, which doesn't quite make sense, but that's just how my brain works. So I went back to school to get my PhD in nursing, and my dissertation was about understanding the relationship between Black racial identity types, postpartum depressive symptoms, using the Edinburgh Postnatal Depressive Scale, maternal functioning, and infant bonding in Black postpartum women living in Georgia. So the Cliff Notes version is that I wanted to see how racial or cultural factors influenced Black women's transition and adaptation to being a mother. And I say Black women because all the participants in my study identified as women. And so as a nursing student, often we're encouraged to find, yes.
Women in rural counties of Georgia too, or?
Okay. Yes, I recruited throughout the state, especially like South, is that Southeast Georgia, because I had connections with the Department of Public Health there. So it was an array from throughout the state, but the majority of participants were from Atlanta and surrounding counties. Mm-hmm. Good question. And so we're often encouraged to find nursing theories that apply to our work. And so I said, okay, nursing theories, I remember this from undergrad at some point. Let me Google it. No, not really, but, you know. So I found the Becoming a Mother theory by Ramona Mercer. And Ramona Mercer lists several different factors that can influence your adjustment to motherhood. But being a minoritized person in a racialized society was not an option, right? It's just not there. They talk about social context, but had nothing to do with race. And so I had to triangulate my conceptual framework with the nigrescence theory, which considers how you feel about being Black in a racialized society, how that affects your psychological distress or well-being. And so I incorporated those two to be my conceptual framework. It was a cross-sectional design. I did primary data collection in the midst of a pandemic. So I relied heavily on social media, but also just Zooming with other pediatric or obstetric providers for recruitment. For my analysis, racial identity is very complex. No one is, you know, a single identity. And so I did a hierarchical cluster analysis to determine the racial identities within the sample, and I conducted an analysis of variance to see the difference in maternal functioning or the difference in depressive symptoms with across those different clusters, as well as multivariate modeling to see which factors heavily influence each of those outcomes. But again, Cliff Notes version. The takeaway from this study, because I won't get into all this. I mean, if you want to read it, it's like several hundred pages, and I can give you the link to download it. But the Cliff Notes takeaway was that there may be some inadequacy in the screening tools that we use to assess Black women for postpartum depression. Also, that Black racial identity types and maternal functioning may help identify Black postpartum women experiencing difficulty adjusting to life with an infant. Like I said, this was in the midst of a pandemic, so again, hope for students. I just published the last paper for my dissertation in January, last month, because I did a traditional dissertation and then decided to split it up into three manuscripts. I don't know if you all have that option, but go for the three manuscript option. In case there's, like, something else going on in the world and your time is, you know. So those are my three publications that talk about the different, you know, aspects of the study. But so I told you about my background, and so we'll come to present day. I am currently, as Dr. Johnson said, in the NCSP at UCLA, which is the National Clinician Scholars Program. It's an interprofessional training within the School of Medicine, and so my co-fellows are physicians, I'm the only nurse, and the fellowship really focuses on how clinician researchers can inform policy but also practice to improve health outcomes. And so my major foci, or focuses, whichever you prefer, during this time has been perinatal health equity, biased and discriminatory care in nursing, as well as community partner research. I also took some time to go to England, specifically London, and I'm going to say this how I feel my friends in London say, Birmingham, because it's not Birmingham, okay? It's not. I learned that over there. It's not. And so you may ask, why England? Because, of course, this was a maternal health policy elective. And so England is the most ethnically and racially diverse city in all of Europe, because some people are like, well, why didn't you go to Sweden or why didn't you go to Norway? They have better outcomes. Well, how many people look like me for me to bring that information back and improve Black maternal health care, Black pregnancy-related health outcomes? So that's why I chose London. Yes, I know there are other countries with better outcomes in Europe. So as you can see here in the UK, the maternal mortality rate, which is how many deaths there are in pregnancy up until about 6 weeks after the end of pregnancy, how many deaths there are in that time, because there are different formulas. So this is maternal mortality ratio. They have 11 deaths per 100,000 births, while in the U.S. our national average is 24 deaths. And so I went there to see exactly what's so different, what works so well, and I learned about the option to have preconception care, so when a person knows when they want to become pregnant, that they can see a general practitioner to be their best self, get in the best health that they can before actively becoming pregnant. They also have midwifery-led care. There you go. I'll work on getting you good reimbursement, I promise. That's one of the things. And I don't like saying default provider because that sounds, I don't know, it sounds weird. It doesn't sound great to me, but that's the word that's coming to mind, that when you become pregnant in the UK, you automatically see a midwife. And then if conditions develop where you need different care, then you would see a physician. So it's midwifery-led care. They also have protocols that stipulate exactly what happens at one point in time. During the pregnancy, also if conditions develop, this is what you do. And so the clinicians are aware of this as well as the patients and the families, so they know what to expect at each visit. And then, of course, you have all the birthing options without worrying about being able to afford these options. You can have a doula without worrying about the cost, or a midwife, or a home birth. It's all part of the options that are built into the healthcare system. It's across the UK, so they have a committee who reviews all the deaths or morbidity each year. And so they come together, and they all have the same electronic medical record system throughout all of the UK, which is why they have so much data and can do these things really quickly. So for an example, at one point in time, preeclampsia was one of the top three causes of maternal mortality in the UK, and the next year it was not, because they met and developed a protocol and it was addressed. And now I think it's the top 13th. I mean, it's not really an issue anymore. And another thing I learned is that there were still reproductive health inequities in the UK because of biased and discriminatory care, poor quality of care, and inaccessible care. So even within a system of universal health care, where theoretically you have the option to choose whichever plan is best for you, there is still gatekeeping that is done by the providers, where some Black and Muslim families did not even know preconception care was an option. And so I still found that there were differences in pregnancy-related health outcomes, one being the death rate. And so as you see here in the UK, white women birthing people have the lowest maternal mortality ratio. So that's 9 deaths per 100,000 live births during pregnancy and up to 6 weeks after the end of pregnancy. But Black women had 34, which is 3.7 times more. A few years ago, it was 5 times different. And that's where the title came from, 5 times more, which Tanuke and Chloe are activists in London, 2 Black women. They're not nurses, they're not researchers, they're not in the healthcare field at all, but they kept hearing about these disparities in death rates, and they decided to do something about it. And so they created their organization, 5 times more, to really bring attention to Black maternal health in the UK, and actually got Parliament to talk about Black maternal health outcomes for the first time ever, like 5 years ago. And so they're still working to address these disparities. And so you can see also here that in the U.S., there's also this disparity. And I did not intentionally leave out Asian people's mortality rates. It is just not available from the national website, from the CDC. So that is why that demographic and others are missing. I searched. It was just not available. And so, again, this is why my own lived experience in being a pregnant woman receiving biased care despite, and you shouldn't have to work in a healthcare system to get bias-free care, but also in seeing the experiences of others and being aware of what's going on, not only nationally but globally, really inspired me to make this my life's work. And so, during my postdoc, which is 2 years, I've worked on a few different things, but I just wanted to highlight very briefly a few. So one is a commentary that it was an invited piece that I co-wrote with my good friend, Neka Okoye, who is a pediatric nurse practitioner and very well-versed in just so many. You know, you have those friends where you're like, how do you even know this? Neka is amazing like that. And so we wrote a piece about racial bias in nursing and really reflecting on what is our individual role, but as well as the discipline, either in perpetuating racial bias, but also how to address it. And so we talked about race-based algorithms and really as drivers of inequities, but also breaking down how race is a social construct, because I feel like people may often say that, but may not really grasp what that means. And so if you want to talk more about that, there's a reception after. And just giving tangible takeaways in this paper on how to challenge your own biases and hopefully impact the care, the nursing care that you provide. I'm currently conducting a mixed method study, which is the Black Mothers Wellness Study, which Iris Cantor, I obtained a grant to conduct this study, where I'm really trying to understand the context of pregnancy visits around mental health. So seeing who discusses mental health with pregnant Black people, what do they say, is it impactful, is it helpful? If you experienced any distress, whether diagnosed or not, how did you get through to the next point in your life? Trying to identify different treatment methods that maybe nursing and medicine in general overlook or maybe minimize because it's not therapy or medication. So in order to provide patient or person-centered care, we have to provide and be knowledgeable about the options that people want to use. So different paths to healing. And then I'm currently in the planning phase. When I was doing my dissertation, I never thought that I'd have multiple projects going on at once. That just seemed like things that senior faculty did. But no, I'm actually doing it. And so I'm planning to kind of analyze Medicaid claims data to see the impact of the American Rescue Plan Act, which is what extended postpartum Medicaid coverage from 6 weeks to a year after childbirth, mainly because it was hoped that, you know, you get postpartum care more often, we can identify risks that could lead to death and prevent death, but also mental health, like what's happening during these visits. Where are you getting care after that if you're being referred for care? Just how is this extension, how did this act actually impact care? And so I'm in LA, and so I have worked with different community organizations. My favorite, don't tell the other sites I said that, my favorite being Kindred Space LA, which is the only Black woman-led community midwifery clinic in all of Southern California. And they are doing amazing things with Black women and birthing people and really allowed me to extend my imagination as to how much we can change the healthcare that we provide. And so I'll get it a little in depth about a current, well, am I under review? I think I'm revised and resubmitted, I don't know. But a publication from this study, the influence of discrimination during childbirth on postpartum care use among Black individuals in California. And so when looking specifically at California, this is a different formula, pregnancy-related death, which is deaths that occur during pregnancy and up to 1 year after the end of pregnancy, so different than maternal mortality ratio. And so California is really good. I'm from the South, so it's been a culture shock, but very good about including data about the various groups of people that live in California. And so even here, you can see the disparity in the death rates. And so, of course, for individual counties, this may even be broader, because within L.A. County, I think the death rate for Black birthing people is 55 per 100,000, depending on which SPA, which is basically health district you live in. And so oftentimes when we see these disparities, we may go to race-based algorithms to figure out why this occurs. But Dr. Geronimus described the phenomena of weathering in 1992 to sort of explain why it appeared that Black pregnant people had worse health. And so this theory kind of considers how it is to be a minoritized person living in a racialized society. Essentially, every experience of discrimination or racism triggers that fight or flight response. And so we're all in school or have been in school, and we know what happens when you're trying to escape a threat, the changes that your body automatically goes through. Well, being a Black person in a racialized society, research shows that you may experience discrimination or racism every day of your life. And so if you are having this autonomic nervous response several times a day, every day of your life, can you imagine the impact that has on your health, whether that's mental or physical? And so the environment essentially weathers on the mental and physical health of Black birthing people, which can explain these disparate outcomes. But also we have to consider the influence of the care that we provide or lack of care that is provided to people also based upon being in a racialized society. And I don't expect you all to be able to read this figure, although designers would say, why would you include a figure that you don't expect people to read? Because it's the principle. And Dr. Hardiman and many colleagues of hers that I look up to that do this work created this conceptual model to illustrate how racism operates and results in the inequities in maternal morbidity and mortality. And so you can see here manifestations in healthcare. And I love this conceptual model. And it shows how in how many ways we can miss the mark in care, but also ways we can improve. And so the purpose of this analysis was to investigate the relationship between discrimination experienced during childbirth hospitalization and then postpartum care use. Because when I showed you the pregnancy-related deaths, the majority of pregnancy-related deaths happen postpartum. And so there's a time period there where it's really important for you to have care so you can clinicians can identify where we can intervene and possibly save a life. And so my thought was, if people experience discrimination during childbirth, because this is secondary data analysis, and so you're confined to the variables that other people, you know, captured. But it's possible that if you experience discrimination while giving birth, you may not want to get postpartum care because you may not want to experience that again. So the sooner I can be done with this relationship, the better. Did you have a question? Okay, sorry. We hypothesized that racial discrimination would result in lower postpartum visits as well as insurance discrimination, but language discrimination would result in a higher number of visits. And this is like all informed from the literature review and things like that. And so this was a secondary data analysis of the Listening to Mothers in California survey, which is a state-level survey of individuals who gave birth in a hospital in California in 2016. And so to be eligible, there were some criteria there, but the main one was that you had to give birth in a hospital, a singleton birth. So often when we think about language discrimination, it's if someone's primary or preferred language is anything other than English, and whether or not a clinician chooses to use an interpreter, whether that's an in-person translator or an app or iPad. This sample, and I'll show you, but this sample was predominantly English speaking, but just to see the different types of discrimination and how that relates to postpartum care use, because those were the three types that were available in the data set. And so previous research has shown that, previous research and anecdotally, when my mother goes to get care, oftentimes patients may not be comfortable in asking questions or asking for clarifying questions. They'll just say, okay, thank you, I'll take this medicine, especially if there's a language barrier, whether that's we literally speak a different language or if I'm using medical jargon and you don't understand. And so, or I'm not explaining myself well enough for you to understand. And so it may take more visits for me to actually grasp what was being said. I'll show up for my visits, and there may be no change in my condition because I didn't do all the things you suggested that I do. And so just his previous research has just shown that when there's a language barrier, they have to come more often for adequate care. Absolutely. Yes. Yes. And so outcome variables, exposure variables, the outcome was the number of postpartum visits within 8 weeks, because, again, that was the time constraint in the data. Racial, health insurance, and language discrimination, which were three separate questions on a five-point Likert scale, I believe, and it literally asked, do you feel you experienced this during your hospitalization? I mean, not whatever. And so for covariates, I looked at sociodemographic and what I like to call clinical variables, like clinician type, whether the type of birth. If these factors also influence postpartum care use, I wanted to minimize the effect of those to really focus on the effects of discrimination. And so for the sample, so this survey sampled from birth certificate data and then weighted the responses to reflect that of the population of California. And so the black postpartum individuals within the data said there were 210, and then you add weights and it makes it way bigger. But on average, they had two postpartum visits, two children, and were 28 and a half years of age. The majority had a high school diploma or GED, used Medi-Cal insurance, vaginal birth, and spoke English, or that was their preferred or primary language. Almost 15% experienced some form of discrimination, but more specifically, 10% was racial discrimination, 7% language discrimination, and 5% insurance discrimination. Like I said, the average number of postpartum visits were two within the sample, but at that time, it was recommended the one postpartum visit because this was before the extension of postpartum Medicaid coverage. This was in 2016. Around 7% did not have any postpartum visits by 8 weeks. And so we did this multiple linear regression to see which factors influence postpartum care use. And this model accounted for a little less than 12% of variance in postpartum care use of the sample. Insurance discrimination was associated with more visits. Less visits. And racial and language discrimination was associated with more visits. And so when we think about insurance discrimination being associated with less postpartum care visits, it's really concerning. Within California, more than half of all births and pregnancies are those patients use Medi-Cal. And so there's a missed opportunity, and if we think about the literal population, to save a life with these pregnant postpartum people who use Medi-Cal. I won't forget. And then for racial and language discrimination, it was associated with more postpartum care visits, which, again, sounds counterintuitive to what I would think about and even previous literature, in that if you experience racism or any sort of discrimination, you don't want to encounter that again. So it would make sense that they would have lesser visits. But I will offer this explanation, and similar to our conversation about language discrimination, in that if because of racism you are offered substandard care, but you may have the same condition, it has not been addressed. So I have to go back to get the standard care because I'm constantly offered substandard care. And I know one or two visits doesn't sound significant, but if, you know, depending on someone's ability to even make that one visit, if they have to come back more, it's just not a good situation. And so as the conceptual model showed earlier by Dr. Hardiman and colleagues, that racism and racial bias can affect healthcare in so many ways, and one of the manifestations is poor quality of care that would result in needing multiple visits to even reach a standard. But you had a question? So if, that's a good question, if someone felt that they were treated differently because of the type of insurance they had, or because of their race, which in this scenario is black, or because of the language that they spoke. And so in looking at the literature, there's not much about language discrimination in the context of the English-speaking environment when the person does speak English. But as you'll find, if you're seeking your PhD, that most of your research leads to more questions that you then find the answers to and create interventions for and go around and around. So maybe that'll be something I delve into later. But there, I still don't understand a lot about that. I don't know if it's specifically medical jargon is being used, and that's the bias or the disconnect, like the barrier. So, of course, with all secondary data analyses, there are limitations just by the nature of the data. You're not collecting it yourself, and you're constrained to whomever the researchers were and the questions they asked. Also, we're asking people who these postpartum people range from 2 to, I believe, 10 months postpartum. So we're asking them to recall how the care was during their hospitalization when they were giving birth. So there's possibility and error, right, from recalling back that far. Also, the complexity of the items that measured experience discrimination. That conceptual model showed how racism or discrimination can show up. It manifests in different ways. And so, yes, there is just blatant racism when you're called certain names, but it can be way more subtle. And so there needs to be questions that pick up on the nuance of exactly how people experience discrimination in order to reform systems and policies. And so what's next for me? My fellowship will be over in June, so I am looking for the next phase in my career. It sounds like the beginning of a Star Trek movie, like, and the saga continues. So continuing to collect data for my Black Mother's Wellness Study, as well as doing more policy research and analyzing the effectiveness of policies that this bill in particular, AB 2193, required that all clinicians who care for pregnant people are required to screen for perinatal mood and anxiety disorders at least once. Once while pregnant, once postpartum. So figuring out, is that efficient? What does that screening look like? Has it resulted in more connection to care? And also reforming nursing education, possibly creating an opportunity, especially for labor and delivery nurses, to learn from doulas and community midwives on the physiology of birth, and not just when intervention is needed to save lives, but also how to support those whose birth plan or ideas may not perfectly fit into hospital policy or protocol. So that's me. You all are so kind. Thank you. Are there any more questions? Yes, I saw Dee first. So acknowledging the importance of doulas is really a geographical issue. In the South, it's not, speaking from my own experience, it's not as, what do I want to say? There aren't as many doulas that I'm aware of in the South, Atlanta specifically, as I have been exposed to here in California. In the South, it was really more of a newly emerging practice. Some people knew about it, some didn't. There is extensive research about the benefits of doulas, specifically about mental health. I'm trying to think. I'll get back to you on that part. But definitely as far as childbirth and pregnancy, an extensive amount of literature about the benefits of a doula. I will say in L.A. County, there are several programs that provide free doulas to Black women and birthing people because it is so well known how they improve health outcomes. And so they provide free doulas to Black women and birthing people who live in certain areas of L.A. County that have the worst mortality rates. However, even when these doulas are offered free of cost, there is still some confusion around, oh, I thought a doula was a midwife, or exactly what does a doula do, or no, I don't need a doula, that's what rich white people do. So there is still a lot of information that needs to be shared and communicating that to the general public and not just researchers knowing the benefits as well. So I think, you know, it depends on where you are and what you've been exposed to as far as embracing doulas and recognizing the impact. But I think, you know, research-wise, there's a lot of evidence. I think you were first.
I actually have two questions.
Okay.
Can you say a little bit more about the divergence theory? And is that a nursing theory? That's question number one. And then the other question is, about what proportion of perinatal deaths are deaths by suicide?
Good question. Let's see which one I know the answer to. No, I'm kidding. So the nigrescence theory became sort of popular in the 60s, and it really centers on how your relationship to being black in a racialized society affects your self-esteem. And so there are racial identities such as miseducated. One of the racial identity clusters I identified was assimilated and miseducated. And these are black people who endorse and support the negative stereotypes associated with black people in America. And surprisingly, they had the best levels of emotional well-being, which is a little different than previous research. But it's also a coping mechanism, right? If you see that black people have a harder time in a when they're minoritized, why, let me pick up some coping skills that would protect me from experiencing that same thing. But there's also a racial identity type called multiculturalist, which you are proud of being black, you love being black, but you also recognize the importance of socializing and being friends with people who are in groups different from you, whether that's race, religion, sexual orientation. And in previous research, people, black people with those identities also had the highest level of emotional well-being and self-esteem. It's also really relevant for youth and figuring out how to attract, specifically for black youth, when they were trying to figure out how to get more black youth into STEM or certain areas where they may not see themselves. That was a really important thing, that even an advertisement or a flyer with a black astronaut would make black youth think, oh, well, maybe I can do STEM. And that's when a lot of advertisement around that was changed. And so it's not a nursing theory. It is sociology, African-American studies. It's Dr. Robert Sellers actually created the tool to measure it and created the theory. And then the second question was around suicide and perinatal death. The most recent publication that I read, or article publication, last week, I think, showed that for black women, mental health is not one of the top causes of perinatal death. For white women, it is. That was recently found due to substance use disorder, intimate partner violence, or death by suicide. And so I think that also shows the importance of collecting data that is reflective of different groups, whether it's by race, ethnicity, language, gender, because then you can tailor interventions that specifically respond to the needs of that community, right? Because if suicide is not one of the top three causes of death in this population, but it is in this population, then it's okay to cater, you know, care for that's most appropriate for the group. Not to say that all of pregnant people don't need to learn about it, but you could identify where you need to intervene. So it's not one of the main causes of perinatal death in black women and birthing people, but, and I can get that most recent publication to you, but I saw it, I think, last week. But yeah, so I thought that was interesting. I thought I saw somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
no risk factors for Black people giving birth are better than, for instance, giving aspirin to people who are Black or pregnant for preventive prevention, or doing additional prevention or using all oxygen have blood pressure have aspirin to
I think, and I'm not as well versed with all of the why that those interventions occur, so I would have to ask you more about that. But I know, if we're talking about asking, and this is, I think this is where community engaged research is important, because if I find that one of the top causes of death in Black person people is X, and Y can help address that. But if I relate that as Black birthing people need aspirin so that they won't have a high risk of death, that if I know that genetically there's not much difference in my DNA from a non-Black person, then why are you targeting me with baby aspirin? Because I have plenty of friends and patients and colleagues who have heard this guidance and refuse their baby aspirin because it's, again, this medical mistrust. So I think we have to be really intentional in communicating why these findings are what they are and why we are offering these specifically to you. And not that it's because racially you're different because that's a social construct, but because this is a driving cause of death within this community and this addresses or prevents that. And so I think that's one thing. I know that AWON, which is the Association of Women's Health Obstetrics and Neonatal Nursing. Is that right? And that's a journal that I'm the associate editor for, so I should know what that is. Has guidelines on providing respectful care to Black women and birthing people. And that is in response to being aware of how biased care shows up and can affect how you provide care. But that's the only guidelines that I'm aware of as far as nursing that addresses biased care that affects a certain group, but not saying, because you are biologically different, you need this intervention in comparison to everyone else. And I think we have to, and even if we did that, if we really thought about why are we saying that this is different for Black people, if it's not based in the construct of race in society, it's probably not biological. So we have to be better about how we communicate that and getting community input to see how this sounds to them and how would you want to learn about this or how would you describe this so that the most well-intended interventions can be well-received and implemented. I think you were next.
What strategies or partnerships have you found to help take all this information and give it to the general public through, story sharing so that our families and our communities, have this information before they even go into their healthcare interaction so that we can, elevate the expectation of healthcare?
So full transparency, I'm a little torn on how much we expect patients and their families to do in the healthcare system. I'm all for self-advocacy and yes, you know your body and all these things. But if we expect the public to know when to believe us or not, or when they're not being provided the best care or not, I've been in school forever and there are still things that I don't know because they're changing. So I'm a little torn about how much we expect people to advocate and hold us accountable as clinicians. We need to hold each other accountable and change the systems to hold us accountable. But as far as storytelling and sharing experiences, I think that's innate in the Black community. And so as good news gets shared as quickly as the not good news. So we know who to go to and who not to. And so I think that can be harnessed. I know I'm going to put Jose on the spot. Jose was there. I don't know if he attended this session, but there was a storytelling session about, Dr. Johnson told me about it earlier, the Rafiki Coalition, is that correct? And they did a storytelling session with us about just how mental health has been addressed with the community and with UCSF Black youth. And so it was all about storytelling, and this is where I was, and this, you know, this was my mental condition at this point in time, and this is how I got through, and this is how I now champion and help clinicians at UCSF. And so it's like a peer support or a liaison in the community that kind of translates and protects between UCSF and the community. And I thought that was really good because, you know, we can say whatever, but it also takes someone in the community to attest to and reassure and protect. And so just always keep the community at the center and seeing what how they want to hear the information and know that there's someone there who has been where they were, that's there to also protect, but also reassure. So I think that was one that I can think of that worked really well.
Great, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I think it's 201.
We are going to continue the conversation at the reception. So please join us up on the nursing mezzanine, just up the stairs, and we'll continue our conversation.
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody.